Right, after observing the video, I think you got the real situations of the indicators with acids and bases. Now, I told you that we are going to discuss an argument here. But the argument is this. You saw that phenolphthalein, I highlight this one, phenolphthalein, for even it is initially in the original color is also colorless, and even for acids, it's become colorless because in the beginning it is in the neutral state, but when it goes to acidic condition, even it shows the colorless state. Therefore, there's a limit in phenolphthalein. You can't identify neutral substances with acidic substances using phenolphthalein. Only you can identify bases, because bases give pink color. And the other thing, there's another argument. You learn about acids and bases, and you learn strong acids and weak acids. See that for any strong or weak, doesn't matter. Litmus gives red color and methyl orange gives red color. And even for bases, doesn't matter strong or weak, respective colors are given for litmus and methyl orange. See that we can understand one thing. Using these indicators, we have another limitation. That is, you can't compare the strength of an acid or a base. We need to know another indicator now. That's what we call logical thinking and analysis. So after learning this thing, that's the thing. You just don't just remember the names. You argue this thing. This is the thing what will happen. So let's see now. So that's why I told you that we are learning about pH indicator in separate way. That's the most important type of indicator in this syllabus and even in the laboratory, because the pH indicator is important to identify even not the acid base, and even for we use it to compare the strength of an acid or a base. So in the indicator you have a scale. pH is an indicator and it has a scale, right? So I here mention black and white picture because after learning your in this tutorial, I just gave it as an activity in here to color it using color pencils. So now I'm in the digital media, I'm just going to transform this into colored view, then you can understand what are the actual colors, right? Now you can see the colors, right? So in these colors, you can see that it's a series of colors starting from green color in the middle and goes to the left side, it becomes reddish color. When go to the right side, it becomes purplish color. See that this pH scale has the idea and the advantage. Even in the top, you can see the pH number. The pH scale is given and the color range is given below. For neutral substances, pH 7, they are giving the neutral nature in that. So the 7 pH is green in color. So from green to left side, it's acidic side, right? So it goes from nearly yellowish green and now gets yellow and orange and red. In here, this red and orange range, dark red and orange range, it gives the high acidity, or strong acids are in that range. The pH level for strong acids will be nearly from 0 to 2, right? The pH for strong acids. 3 to 6, the pH range will be weak acids, right? So they are giving the respective colors, nearly yellow and pale orange in color, right? Even same thing happens to bases also. Strong bases will be in the pH of 12 to 14. So its strong bases give purple and dark blue color. Pale blue color and greenish blue color is given for weak bases in here. So like that, you can now understand pH indicator is a very important indicator to compare the strength of acids and bases, because even for neutral, it gives a specific color. So due to that reason, pH indicator is known as the universal indicator, right? Remember that thing. And the colors, you can just randomly remember the colors because it's very important. Now you have learned 4 different types of indicators. Now it's time I just make an activity here to discuss and argue. From this activity you can get a large amount of knowledge what we discuss in here. Usually this is the practical that you have in your textbook to discuss. Here, this practical, I will give the observations in the practical, do the practical in separate video. So you can observe that separately and come back to this table. So I just want to discuss this table after you observe the video in that particular practical video. So after that, you will get these results, because you are going to add these litmus and all these indicators and see for these chemical substances. You just learn about strong and weak. No? Now you are using actual acids and bases and observe the colors what they give. Now after getting these results, I want to argue and I want to discuss this thing in more detail. So this is the way we are going to discuss it. So you can see all the information is given in here. In here, I will discuss it like this. You know that I will just introduce these things, hydrochloric and sulfuric and even lime juice. They are giving nearly strong nature, but lime juice little bit weak in strength, and these two will consider as strong acids here, sulfuric and hydrochloric acid. And vinegar lime juice we can consider as weak acids, right? And here soap, lime water and soap we can consider as very weak bases. I mean, not very weak, generally weak bases. And dilute sodium hydroxide is considered as a strong base. So what I told in the beginning about the weaknesses, I mean, I can't say weaknesses, the shortcomings in that using litmus, phenolphthalein and methyl orange is proved in here. See that? You know that sodium chloride is a neutral substance because it's a product of salt, acid and a base. Sodium chloride is a salt which is a product of an acid called hydrochloric acid and the strong base called sodium hydroxide. See that for sodium chloride, phenolphthalein gives colorless, and even for these acids, it gives colorless. So are you able to compare acids and bases using this? Sorry, acids and neutrals using phenolphthalein. So there's a small shortcoming in this thing. And in the here, and in this you can see, all for all the acids, litmus gives red color. Even strong or weak doesn't matter. So you prove the other part, that methyl orange and litmus are not able to compare the strength of the acid. But here you can see pH indicator prove it. Strong acids, it gives the strong range, the red color. For weak acids, it gives the yellow range. See that. So you can understand now the argument is correct. pH indicator is the most suitable indicator, not only for identifying acids and bases, other than that, to compare the strength of acids and bases. And even neutral, it gives a separate color. See that from this observation, that those are the conclusions you make. So you can take these ideas again, listen to this again and again, and you are able to write the conclusion. That you have given a big space here. You are writing all the conclusions you observe from this experiment, what I have discussed up to now, using the video I have mentioned in here. So you can pause the video and rewind it and see again and again, observe again and again, and take the ideas thoroughly, and you can write those things here, because you need those things when you are arguing for a finding an answer in MCQ. Always you get in a trouble because two similar answers will be there, two very equally similar answers will be there. From those two, to identify the best answer, you need to know properly what is actually happening. So it's time for you to write the conclusions you mentioned, we discussed in here in this table. After learning about conclusions, we are shifting to the next part of the lesson. Right. After learning those practical ideas, our final theoretical part we are learning is neutralization. So this lesson, this part is little bit familiar to you now, because you learn what is acid-base reaction. When an acid reacts with a base, salt and water is produced. You know that. So what we call neutralizing. The strength of the acid and the base is cancelled. you don't have no more acid and basic nature, and that is called neutralization. So how it happens? We have the problem. If you logically think, we have the problem in that. So let's see this thing. You know, acids, they become acids because they release H+. Whenever you have H+ in the medium is acidic. And here in the base, it releases OH-. Whenever you have OH-, the medium is basic. Now the thing is, when these two react, what will produce? You know it. When these two combine, you produce water. Right, H2O. In this result, no more H plus and OH minus, you have water. So is it having acidic basic nature? No more. So this is called neutralization. When H plus combine with OH minus, and here the theory given, that combination result neutralization, no more strength. So I'll give one example here, just we learned previously also. If you assume that one example I always just mention, the stomach is acidic due to the acid hydrochloric acid, right? And we are having a medicine called Belsit syrup or milk of magnesia containing magnesium hydroxide, right? So you know why it's bracketed and 2 is put, because you can understand that the valence number causes the balance in the one cation and anion in here to make the formula. Now we have to understand what are the products. You know that water is the default product it produces. Then you can understand how to write the salt, right? You know, you need to know that. Salt, water is produced in here by donating the H plus and OH minuses in this acid and the base. So these two will not no more because it forms water. The remaining compounds will be, you can see that here, the remaining compound will be this one and this one here. So these two will combine and form the salt. But remember, when you are writing the equation, you need to follow the valence number to write the formula, right? So magnesium and chlorine will react. So they form and combine, not react, actually they combine and form the product here. So you have, before you write the product correctly, you are going to check the valence numbers. Magnesium valency 2, chlorine valency 1. So they exchange the valence numbers, you can get MgCl2. That's one of the thing you have to do. Don't be lazy, you have to do this, otherwise you just write MgCl. So the whole equation is wrong there, because you are going to balance this after this. You get magnesium chloride. Now 50% of the equation is done. Now balancing part is there. You can see magnesium balance here. Magnesium is okay, 1 and 1. Water, you can see water, I will take hydrogen, 2 hydrogen here and here 1 hydrogen. There should be 3 hydrogen, but here 2 hydrogen is there. So we need to make it 3. So if you put 3 here, it becomes 6. Now there's a problem. You have to understand the problem here. The problem here is chlorine is not balanced. Right, if you make the chlorine balance, you can make it easy to put 2 here, it becomes 4. See this thing, chlorine here 1, here 2. So I put 2 here, you can't put 2 here, so I'll put 2 there, right in here. So when automatically hydrogen becomes twice, so 2 hydrogen, 2 hydrogen, 4 hydrogen you have, so you can put 4 here, 2 here. By putting 2 here, you can get the equation balanced. See that? Get the idea, right? That's what we call neutralization, and you know how to write the equation now. You are confident in that. Now I just gave some examples of neutralization applications. I quickly explain these stuff. First thing, you already know the acidity of the stomach is due to acidic HCl, so it will be neutralized by using magnesium hydroxide like weak bases. Second thing, normally before the cultivation is done, due to the drainage of water, so soil becomes much acidic. So acidic nature is sometimes not good for some plant roots. So before you cultivate or plant new plants in the field, you have to make the soil neutralized. The acidic soil should neutralize. So people will spray, the farmer will spray quicklime. So there's a small mistake to correct the formula. Quicklime is calcium oxide. This is limestone, calcium carbonate. You have to make the correction. The correction will be calcium oxide. Calcium oxide is CaO. This is called quicklime. So I will tell you how it is produced. Obviously, calcium carbonate is thermally decomposed. By heating, it's thermally decomposed to make, we are producing producing heat here. We produce calcium oxide and carbon dioxide gas. This is the reaction. This is called quicklime, right? By mash or quicklime. So, and this is the limestone mineral found in the soil on the earth, right? Right. And the thing is, when you add even that or wood ash also, you can neutralize the acidity of the soil. And the other thing, even bee sting, the poison in the bee sting is acidic substances. That's why you get a huge pain in that. So to relieve the pain, you can apply even quicklime. Here also the correction should be there. And also you are adding baking soda. It's also a weak base. You can understand what is a weak base from this thing, because you have argument that sodium should combine with hydroxide to make it base. But I will tell you why it is having basic properties from this table, right? So bee sting neutralized, and the strength of the acidity in the neutralized by using the application of these two products. And the reverse will happen here. Wasp sting is basic substances are there in the wasp sting. To weaken the power of the wasp sting, what we're going to do, we apply either weak acids here like lime juice or vinegar. As the last part of this session, we are learning about salts. So I put this salt lesson at the end, because then you can study, you can understand actually what is a salt, because you know what is acid and a base after this. So during a reaction between acid and a base, you know that salt is produced. That part very well you know, but there's a small thing to learn additionally, that is the property of the acid, I mean the strength of the acid and the base will be responsible for the nature of the salt. So if you consider the example here, I just put HCl and sodium hydroxide as strong bases and produces sodium chloride. So in the above you can see neutral salt. It says it's a neutral salt. So what do you mean by neutral? When a strong acid, a strong base, they have similar strengths, when they react, they produce a neutral salt. That means you can understand, in a strong acid, strong base reaction, the salt is showing neutral property. So let's go to the next idea. I took this example here. You can see a strong acid is HCl and weak acid is, sorry, weak base is ammonium hydroxide. So it produces a salt, you know that, it's ammonium chloride. But you can see here, it mentioned that is an acidic salt. What do you mean by this acidic salt? That means the priority in this combination is given for the strong one. That means if the acid is strong, the salt is showing little bit of acidic properties. So that means that's the understanding, the derivation in here you can mention. And that method you can understand that the priority is given for the strong one. So then you can understand the third one very easily. I took this example as the third one. So weak acid is the carbonic acid we took here, hydrogen carbonate. And here you can have strong base, right? Strong base is sodium hydroxide, right? So here you can understand one idea. The strength is more in the base than the acid. So a salt which is produced is showing a tiny or little bit of basic properties, because the strength is given by the base. Last one. Now in this example you can see I took weak acid as carbonic acid and weak base as ammonium hydroxide. So when these two also react, you know the strengths are similar, weak and weak. So it produces a neutral salt called ammonium carbonate. You know why these two came from? Because of the valency balancing in here and what is produced. So you can understand the basic behavior and the reason why salts are in different forms according to the strength of the acid and the base. As the last thing what we are going to learn now is this statement, final thing. It says a certain idea about a property of a salt. It says most of the salts dissolve in water. That's okay because most are ionic compounds and have a higher melting and boiling points. What do you mean melting and boiling points? It's a specific temperature where water melts and ice melts and water boils, right? So they are saying this idea that salt, when you dissolve salt in water, that melting and boiling points, standard numbers, for example, melting point of ice is 0 Celsius, boiling point of water is 100 Celsius. So these numbers, these values will change. And here I mention, to understand that idea why the melting and boiling points increase. So normally, in between water molecules in water, there are attractions. Right? Due to the polarity present in water molecule, so negative positive attractions will be there like this. For example, electronegativity of oxygen is more compared to hydrogen, so it takes the delta negative charge, that means tiny negative charge. So between those two charges, they form attractions in here. Like this, you can see attractions will form. So these are called hydrogen bonding or hydrogen interactions, and also we call them intermolecular attractions, right? So these attractions will cause the water to become a liquid, remain as a liquid though you heat it. After 100 Celsius, you can see water starts to boil. But due to interactions that's there, we have to heat it up to 100 Celsius to boil it. But when salt is dissolved, for example, I will dissolve sodium chloride. Common salt we use, sodium chloride, in water. See what will happen to the in between the water molecules, what will happen to that. Here you can see after dissolving sodium chloride in water, they form new attractions, right? See this one, they form new attractions because static attractions will create between the water molecules and the sodium and chloride ions. So this causes the water molecules to held tight together more than before. So there's a reason. Now you can understand why the boiling point and melting point increases when you dissolve salts, because they will improve the attractions and increase the intermolecular forces and make it unable to heat and unable to change the state easily. So this is the idea you have to understand here. So after these things, you can now think about the idea, what are the what are the questions they will ask about these lessons what we learn up to now, acids, bases and salts. So they will ask logical questions. So if you have doubts, again observe the video and get the understanding very properly, because more details are there in this tutorial. So, and also I'm giving some questions related to these things, so you can try those questions leisurely, so and understand the way they will ask questions about this lesson. So have a nice day, everyone.